being frozen alive. Gives me chills just thinking about it. I don't even like iced coffee. I do, however, love a good story. When we think of somebody being frozen, we usually imagine it as being, well, a one-way street. But fringe cases across history have shown us that, due to reasons both mysterious and fascinating, the human body can take on the coldest of nature's elements and survive. A movie came out this year titled Breakthrough, based on the true story of a young boy from St. Louis who fell through a frozen lake and, miraculously, survived. We'll be examining that particular case, alongside other similar events, in order to figure out the following. What happens to a person when they're frozen alive? What medical steps are taken to help recovery? And, most fascinating of all, what happens to those who come back to life? Let's find out. John Smith, a teenager from St. Louis. Michelle Funk, a 2-year-old girl from Salt Lake City. Justin Smith, a mid-20s man from Lee Valley. What do all these people have in common? Well, I mean, outside of two of them coincidentally having the same last name. No relation, by the way. Well, each one of them can say that they've died once, which, as far as icebreakers go, is pretty impressive. How does that work? Well, before we get into the idea of how one returns to the living, we need to look into the science of how someone is considered dead.
I'm not dead!
Yeah, he says he's not dead.
Yes, he is.
I'm not!
I reckon a lot of us think that it'd be easy to declare someone deceased. Kind of like declaring that the sky is blue or that coffee needs to be hot. Some things just seem obvious. But when a doctor is pressed to determine if a person has truly passed on and to call a time of death, certain things have to be considered. For one, a person can be declared clinically deceased if they do not have a pulse, or if the patient cannot breathe for an extended amount of time. Of course, this classification is far from simple. Worldwide definitions for death can widely vary, but for these cases we'll be focusing on the pulse and breathing. John, Justin, and Michelle are three examples wherein someone was determined to be clinically deceased after enduring extreme levels of freezing temperatures. John Smith had fallen through a frozen lake and was submerged for 15 minutes. When his body was recovered, he had no pulse and had no sign that he was breathing. Justin Smith was found by his father, frozen solid, deep within a foot of snow. When the paramedics arrived, they could not find a heartbeat. Michelle Funk, remarkably, spent 66 minutes submerged in a freezing cold lake. When she was finally pulled out, they found no signs of breathing from her, and a heart monitor couldn't pick up a pulse. All three were clinically dead when found, frozen solid, only to fully recover and return to the living. What happened? Before we get a little ahead of ourselves, let's explore the science behind how the human body deals with extreme temperatures. So what happens when the body begins to freeze? In order to explore that idea, we'll first have to learn about hypothermia. When everything is running smoothly, the average temperature for the human body sits comfortably between 97.7 and 99.5 degrees Fahrenheit. This state of temperature is known as normothermia. Things can get even steamier, as high as 99.5 or 100.9 degrees Fahrenheit if you're running a fever. This is known as hyperthermia. Hypothermia, on the other hand, is when the core body temperature is below 95 degrees Fahrenheit. At this point, the body is now losing more heat than it can absorb. Mild cases can show symptoms of shivering with some confusion. Now, confusion might not sound too frightening on paper, but the severity of this type of psychological trauma can widely vary, with extreme cases resulting in a phenomena known as paradoxical undressing, which, terrifyingly, leads people to undress from their clothing as confusion leads them to believe they're actually overheating rather than freezing. As you can imagine, removing the one thing keeping you warm at a time like this does not help matters. But confusion might not be the only thing at play here. Some studies cite the response as a chemical slip-up in the hypothalamus, the part of the brain responsible for regulating body heat. Another behavior that has been observed in extreme cases of hypothermia is called terminal burrowing, which has people searching for a tight, enclosed area in their final moments, hiding away in something like a wardrobe or closet. So yeah, throwing all your clothes off as you shiver in a file cabinet is a pretty grim way to go. But what if you make it through the elements? What can modern medicine provide? Well, there are a few techniques we can use to treat those chills. And you know we're on the right path because all of these methods contain the word warm in it somewhere. Good call. First, we've got passive rewarming, which I like to call the cozy maneuver. Basically, you've got a very light case of hypothermia. The medicine? A warm blanket and some hot chocolate. Well, that's not too bad. This may come as a surprise, but passive rewarming is about as good as it gets when we're talking about personal comfort. Another method is called airway rewarming, usually applied with a mask that provides humidified oxygen to the patient in an attempt to warm the body. And then there's the method we'll be referencing the most from here on out, extracorporeal rewarming. Remember when we talked about things getting less comfortable? This practice has the patient's blood drawn, warmed, and returned to the body. If that makes you feel uneasy, just think of it as reheating some coffee in the microwave and putting it back in a thermos. In most circumstances, extracorporeal rewarming is after a patient has undergone surgery. When under surgery, the patient's blood is intentionally cooled in order to slow down their metabolism, which assists in limiting the risk of brain damage. This method was used to save Michelle Funk's life, but the decision to undergo this type of procedure is never an easy one. With regards to Michelle, her case was in 1988, when this was still a new technique, and as I mentioned before, her situation was extreme. She had spent 66 minutes submerged in a frozen lake, at the age of 2. Her temperature, coincidentally, was also 66 degrees Fahrenheit. Just let that sink in for a moment. At that point in time, this was the longest someone had ever recovered from being submerged that long under freezing temperatures. Recovery in this case meaning that, while not having a pulse or signs of breathing, her brain was still intact. Pediatric cardiologist Dr. Robert J. Bolt would have to consider not just whether or not extracorporeal rewarming would be effective, but whether the combination of the procedure alongside the absolutely insane level of hypothermia could result in Michelle sustaining significant brain damage. Despite this, Dr. Bolt encouraged Michelle's parents that they go through with the operation, seeing it as the only option they had at that point in time. After some time with extracorporeal rewarming, Michelle's temperature had begun to rise. Once it had reached 77 degrees Fahrenheit, the on-site medical staff had heard the one thing that could keep their hope alive, a gasp of air from the 2-year-old girl. Michelle would, thanks to the ever-evolving world of medical science, recover without any lasting life-debilitating problems, leading a normal life like the rest of us today. Decades later, the same technique would be used in similar cases of extreme hypothermia, including Justin Smith.
So Justin's case, from what we can tell, is the lowest recorded body temperature to ever survive exposure from hypothermia.
Although in Justin's case, he was found in a snowbank as opposed to being underwater, leading to some tissue damage and amputation.
He did end up amputating both of his pinkies and all of his toes.
Obviously huge impacts to his life, but he appears to be doing very well otherwise. John Smith's recovery was represented in the film Breakthrough, though in the movie his recovery has a more faith-based element to it. It is worth mentioning that the traditional practice of hypothermic treatment was still in use. While extracorporeal rewarming wasn't cited directly, other techniques like passive rewarming
covered him with a huge bear hugger to warm his body.
And airway rewarming were practiced, as well as 27 minutes of CPR in an attempt to restart his heart. These three cases are among many extreme hypothermia-related incidents. But if you look up any of these stories or cases similar to it, you'll likely find headlines noting how the individuals had died and come back to life. It's a bold statement, and one that has a different meaning across the planet. So, with that in mind, what does it mean to be declared deceased under these circumstances? The cases we've researched all had a moment wherein, medically speaking, the individuals were considered dead. Obviously that wasn't the case, but they did tick a few boxes on the checklist for death. No pulse and no breathing, right? Well, there are many opinions on what it means to be declared dead. Some opinions on it comes from the doctors themselves. A common phrase being, "You're not dead until you're warm and dead." This is a quote by Dr. Gerald Coleman, the person who saved Justin Smith's life. That's because freezing temperatures aren't governed by the traditional rules. As we've seen demonstrated, individuals can survive despite not having a heartbeat or sign of breathing. If you liked that first quote, here's another good one. "We've learned that there really is no temperature so low that you shouldn't try to save someone." That's from thermophysiologist Gordon Geisbrecht, who is affectionately and professionally known as Professor Popsicle, which, by the way, would be an excellent superhero name. All of this is to say that, under these circumstances, not having a heartbeat or a sign of breathing isn't necessarily grounds to believe someone is truly deceased. As the body cools, its metabolic rate slows down. As described during our research into extracorporeal rewarming, a slower metabolism allows the brain and other life-sustaining organs to survive on a lower amount of oxygen. When things get colder, that metabolic rate slows down even further, gradually bringing the body to a point of suspended animation. Suspended animation, of course, looks about as lifeless as you can get. But think of it more like the body being on pause, capable of resuming, provided the right treatment is applied. So, in a really crazy way, enduring that level of hypothermia very well may be what protected these frozen alive cases from death. But we're not the only ones cheating death against nature. Cold-blooded creatures, like certain frogs, have adapted through countless cycles of evolution to freeze and thaw themselves as winter comes and goes, lowering their metabolic rate to a near complete halt and preserving themselves in a state of suspended animation. There are even some fish, like the Antarctic toothfish, that have evolved to live in water as cold as 28.4 degrees Fahrenheit, thanks to having blood that can be described as having antifreeze-like qualities. And if you haven't had the pleasure of meeting one yet, the microscopic organism known as the tardigrade, or water bear, is capable of enduring a frozen state for up to 30 years, possibly more, and make a 100% recovery. And also, he's so cute! Where was I? Though, yes, being declared dead can be a great headline, it might actually do a disservice to the science of what is actually going on. This leads us back to the John Smith case. The movie Breakthrough is, at its core, a story about a mother who is doing everything she can to get her son back. It is by no means a movie meant to educate others on the effects of hypothermia or the concept of suspended animation, but because it is based on a true story, I feel it necessary to point out some of the differences between the story and the truth. For example, some of the character motivations are heavily dramatized in order to better fit the religious themes of the film. In the movie, John's rescuer, Tommy Shine, expresses that there was some voice underwater guiding him toward John. Though, in real life, Tommy hasn't said anything about hearing a voice that helped him rescue the boy. The advertising for the film also suggests that doctors had given up on procedures to revive John before his mother started praying.
Send your Holy Spirit to save my son!
When, in actuality, John's mother is quoted saying that the doctor's efforts were still underway during that moment.
When I first walked in there, I couldn't believe how many people were in the room. There were probably at least 25 professionals in there that had been working on John. So I walked up to the end of his bed, and the young man that had been, was still doing CPR on him, you could tell that he was just really frantically working on my son.
I think it's important to stress these differences, not as a means to take away from the spiritual elements of the film, but to ensure that we don't confuse fact from fiction. The film portrays the events of John's revival in a way that suggests prayer being what ultimately saved his life, when in reality there are many other explanations to consider. Look, I'm not here to tell you whether or not placing your faith in something is worthwhile, that's for you to decide. But I am here to tell you that the wondrous ingenuity of modern medicine and the absolutely powerful will our species has to survive cannot be ignored. The risks that we take to live and learn for another day is, well, pretty dang cool. Hey, you know, these puns are making me feel a little isolated. Yikes. Okay, this is getting out of hand. I think I might need something to warm up with.